we're here, of course, for poetry reading, prose reading. Most of you know me. My name is Charles Byrne. I'd like to welcome you to Southeastern Community College and tonight's Visiting Writers Series presentation. Before we begin, I'd like you to take a moment, please, to check your cell phones, make sure they're on silent, or turn them off. Most people don't know how to turn them off anymore, but at least put it on silent, please. And if you can't do that, we can throw them out the back door over there. All right, thank you very much. I've been asked to read this advisory, so I will. Some of the material presented this evening may include mature subject matter, such as drug use and abuse, sexuality, profanity, and violence. So we can all look forward to that. Our guest for the evening is Dennis Maulsby, a longtime writer of prose and poetry. We are honored to have him here with us tonight, so please welcome him with your applause. Tonight's event will include a presentation by Mr. Maulsby, and the program will be followed by a brief question and answer session. After the question and answer session, you are invited to join us for free refreshments in room 202, which is at the end of the hall to the left as you leave this room. We usually have refreshments in the cafeteria. That's being used tonight by another group. So when we exit at the end of the program, we'll go out here to the left instead of the right. Left, right. There's all kinds of goodies down there. It looks great. I tested them before you guys got here. I'll be introducing our guests shortly, but first I'd like to thank everyone who is making tonight's presentation possible, including the SCC Board of Trustees, SCC administrators, staff and faculty, SCC's Culture on Campus Committee, the management and staff of the Black Hawk Cafe, members of SCC's Dedante Literature and Writing Club, tonight's reader, Mr. Maulsby, and of course, all of you, SCC students, members of the community, and other guests in the audience. Our Visiting Writers series is supported by SCC's Culture on Campus Committee, the SCC Foundation, SCC's Dedante Literature and Writing Club, the Burlington Fine Arts League, Burlington Area Arts Council, and the Society of Great River Poets, along with many other local businesses that are listed in your programs. Please give all of these folks a round of applause. And now for our guest, Dennis Maulsby, formerly of Burlington, Iowa, is a retired bank president living in Ames, Iowa. His poetry and short stories have appeared in Lyrical Iowa, the North American Review, Haiku Journal, Spillway, the Hawaii Pacific Review, the Briarcliff Review, and numerous other journals. Mr. Maulsby's first book of war poetry, Remembering Willie and All the Others, won Silver Medal Book Awards from the Military Writers Society of America and the Branson Stars and Stripes Organization. Subsequent collections include Frisson, Near Death, Near Life, and a book of linked poetry and short stories, Free Fire Zone. In May 2004, Mr. Maulsby's poem, 6 June, Omaha Beach, was featured with a musical background on National Public Radio's Themes and Variations in memory of the 60th anniversary of the World War II Normandy landings, and his poem, Isle Royale Hunted, received a Pushcart Prize nomination in 2011. Mr. Maulsby is a past president and current member of the Iowa Poetry Association. He also holds memberships in the National Federation of State Poetry Societies, the Military Writers Society of America, the Urbandale Omega Poets, the Ankeny Writers Workshop, the International War Veterans Poetry Archives, and the Society of Great River Poets in Burlington, Iowa. Please welcome Dennis Maulsby to SCC.
I'd like to add my thanks to the ones House had just handed out. You know, Iowa is a great state to learn to write in and to write in. You know, we've got lots of treasures here. And of course, this college, Chuck, those are two treasures you've got if you want to be a writer. We've also got, of course, the oldest MFA program in the United States, the granddaddy of them all up in Iowa City. And there's an unrelated spinoff to that, that if you haven't heard about, it's something you ought to think about. But it's called the Iowa Summer Writing Festival. They've had, it's been going now for the last 15 or 20 years. And they have workshops that you can attend, either weekends or maybe a full week. I think they even have some two-week workshops. And they bring writers in from all over the world to conduct these workshops. It's any kind of writing. You write poetry, you want to be a playwright, you want to be a novelist, short stories, you know, whatever you are working on. It's a really a wonderful place to go. They have very, very small classes, usually about 15 people. And people come all over the world to go there. I went to about seven of them as part of my evolution as an author. And in some cases, some of the classes, the workshops, I was the only guy from Iowa. So it's a really good, great way to meet some people from other parts of the states and other parts of the world. So consider that. Let me pick up my lost papers. And again, I'd like to thank and recognize as treasures that you have access to in writing. The SEC Culture on Campus Committee, the Dante Literature and Writing Club. Do we have members of the Dante here tonight? All right. Like the Three Musketeers. The Burlington Arts Council, Burlington Fine Arts League. You know, I remember even when I was here some 20 years ago that Chuck was bringing in writers. City was very supportive. The Society for River Poets were sponsoring people. They sponsored, one time when I was here, we had the Poet Laureate of the United States come in, who happened to be in Iowa. So it was interesting. Poetry is frequently a pretty hard sell. But we had 60 or 70 people come in for the Poet Laureate. And he got up and he looked out at the audience, and there was a lot of couples, and he says, well, I can see the wives have drug a lot of their husbands here tonight. And of course, a lot of the husbands were nodding. By the time he got through with the evening, you know, the husbands who have been drugged there were saying, oh, this is wonderful. This guy comes again, I'm going to be here. You know? So poetry can be a great performance art. I had a plan when I first got into writing. And that plan was to start out with poetry. So I really like the way poetry has imagery, it has sensuality. You can kick over all the rules, you don't have to obey grammar. Isn't that wonderful after all those years of being forced to be grammatically correct, or at least trying? And poetry, you don't have to do that. You can do whatever you want, you can really kick over the rule book. So I started out with poetry. And once I thought I had learned enough there, I wanted to go take that, what I'd learned about poetry, and try to bring it into prose, try to bring it into short stories, take that imagery, take that sensuality, see if you could put it into prose. So then I wanted to do short stories. Then I wanted to do novels. So where am I at in my plan? Well, I've done the poetry and continue to do it. Near Life, Near Death is my first book of traditionally published poetry. You know, Turner bought the manuscript, paid me some money up front, and I also get royalties. So, the book has recently, last year, won a couple of national awards. It was a best book finalist, and it also won a gold medal award from the Military Writers Society of America. Also, Thursday of this week, I received an email. It started out, congratulations. I thought, oh no, you know, the president is increasing the military, and I've just been drafted again. But that wasn't the case. It's congratulations. As part of the Eric Hoffer Award, Near Death, Near Life, he's nominated for the DaVinci I. award is awarded to books, outstanding cover art. So it's gotten two awards for the, what was inside of it, and it's been nominated for an award for what's outside it. Of course, I can't take any credit for the outside. Some of you probably know if you've done your research. Unless you sell a manuscript to a printer, to a publisher, that they have the right to do the cover. And you don't have, you know, and they'll put on what they want. Now maybe they'll listen to you, maybe they won't. But so I called the publisher, I said, hey, you've been nominated for an award. The late last year, the same publisher that did my poetry book also had agreed to do my book of blank short stories, Pre-Fire Zone, and it was printed. It was released in November of last year. So we have the poetry book, we have the short stories. I've got about three novels in draft, and so I'm trying to find a publisher now that would be willing to publish one of the novels to continue with my evolution as a writer. And I trace back the beginning to this community, to Burlington, and I had decided that I needed some kind of creative activity to help me with the demons that I had inherited from being in Vietnam. And so I saw this little ad in the paper, Society of Great River Poets is having meetings. I thought, well, maybe I should try writing. Creativity is a great way, it's a great therapy, a great way to deal with problems you might have. So I went to their meeting. They had, this meeting was in a department store, a local department store downtown. It was in the basement. And it was right near all the knickknacks and oddities. I thought, what a great metaphor. As it was, you know, the poets frequently are looked at that way. They're knickknacks and oddities. And of course, the knickknacks and oddities usually are the most interesting things. That instead of being a stamped out type of product, where everything's similar, and you buy one, it's exactly the same as the other. You're getting a lot of unique capabilities. So, if you ever feel, if you're a poet, that there's something odd about you, you're probably right. And there's nothing wrong with that. My wife thinks we're all crazy, in some form or fashion. But we're the ones that make sure that people understand what's going on in the world through use of our writing. Okay, so I would also recommend the Society of Great River Poets to you, that if you're a poet or want to dabble in poetry, this is a great group to go to. And they make a very safe environment where you don't have to feel nervous or scared about reciting your poetry. And they'll give you some excellent feedback. So, poetry, short stories, potential novel. Maybe in a year or 2 years, I'll be here again reading from a novel. In the meantime, I'd like to be in the audience listening to some of you guys and gals up here reading. So, maintain your evolution as well. Give you some samples. The poetry book, Near Death, Near Life, is named that because a lot of it is about my experience in the military, most of which is very near death. But I found after about 5 years of reading, writing poetry, and writing about the military experiences I had, that the therapy was so good, I could write about other stuff. It wasn't necessarily connected with violence or the things that I was working on. So there's near life poetry in here. I tried to alternate it so that the reader won't be scared to death reading four or five, you know, near-death poems in succession. Let me give you some samples. People that have experienced trauma, whether it has to do with military-induced trauma, or whether it's civilian, because people can, you know, not be in the military and still have traumatic events happen to them. They tend to live in two worlds. They live in this world that we're in. And you see us, you experience, you share experiences with them. But at any given moment, something could trigger them to go back to this other world. The poem is called Sweat Dreams. Near my hunting boots, a broke-back rabbit jerks. Blood smell, knife pricks my nostrils. Soldiers' bodies twitch in the grass. A fire-black, glass-shuttered chivvy squats in a ditch. Shadows chase the wrecker's throbbing light. A rocket-propelled grenade's magma hot sun, overturned smoked Jeep. Faces burnt off. The syrup stink of a packing plant's slaughtered hogs flushes through the car vents. My vibrant soul jungle boots deadlift mud, repetition after repetition, slog between day-old bullet-flowered corpses. In the corral's dry gray dust, a dead cow, ballooned with August heat, waits the knacker's truck. Dead soldiers, swollen innards burst, flies deposit human grease on my hands and face. One of the near death, now let me give you something that's near life. This is a poem I wrote while I was here in Burlington. It was first published in the North American Review, which I don't know if you're aware of, but that's published out of the University of Northern Iowa. And the North American Review is the oldest poetry journal in the United States, another treasure we have here in the state of Iowa. And I think one or two of our Society of Graver Poets have been also published in that magazine. But check it out. It's a good resource and another treasure that the poets among you. And I need to take short stories too, so I would definitely check that out. It was also published in an English literature journal in China by the name of Terracotta Typewriter. It takes place in the man cave, laying on the couch, being a couch potato, watching television. My son was right next to me and he was lifting weights, not paying particular attention to what was on the TV. And I'm an adopted Korean son. My Asian son lifts weights, black cast iron discs ringed together with each of his curls. A musical beat in 4/4 time. On the TV, a PBS crew explores the ancient Qin Emperor's tomb. An army of terracotta soldiers arranged there on parade. The cameras do profiles, pans, and close-ups. Statues, thin-lipped faces, high cheekbones, and Asian eyes. On the screen, my son's image animates the molded faces as if he had been the model for the 2,000-year-old sculpted clay. The empty shells clutch life, brows lift, black eyes shine again, gray pottery cheeks flush tan, lips part and nostrils flare. Finished with his sets, a red hibiscus silk shirt pulled over his head, my son strides from the house. In his silvered sunglasses, shields flash, banners wave, 10,000 warriors bow. Any of you seen documentaries on the terracotta soldiers? Fantastic stuff, right? Free Fire Zone, the transition piece. 17 linked short stories, each introduced with a poem. So maybe there's some hybrid vigor there. Poem gets you in the mood for the short story. So I tried to specially select those so that you read the poem and gets you kind of in the mood for what's going to come in the short story. And this was a learning experience. So each of these stories is a different genre. What a great way to learn. It's like little etudes in music, studies, little studies that you do to learn how to write all these different kinds of genres. There's a detective, murder mystery, action adventure, horror, stories dealing with terrorists, a western, a romance, ghost story. We have any lovers of H.P. Lovecraft, the horror story writer. There, I try to like one where I kind of model a little bit of the action after him. And there's suspense. There's also one where the hero is approached by the devil, deal with the devil. And that's one way to become a writer, is you make a deal with the devil, right? And that's what he's offered. He wants to be a writer. So let's see what the devil offers him. I had to give him credit. The devil shrugged off my attempts to be playful and proceeded like the vastly experienced salesperson he was. Cutting to the chase, his offer was to make me a successful writer, poet, essayist, playwright, novelist. I could do all these. Any form of writing in which I wished to indulge would be published and receive acclaim. A sufficiency of money would be forthcoming. But he allowed that in his reading of my needs, fame as an author appeared primary and wealth secondary. A side benefit, the intellectual women to whom I was always attracted, and with whom I had always been unsuccessful, would vie for my attention. Well, you know, it's like John Wayne said when asked by Barbara Walters why he always married women of Latin or Spanish descent. The Duke said, every man picks his own poison. As I sat silent, enjoying silk sheet pictures in my mind, he upped the ante with movie contracts for the novels. I came out of my reverie, looking for pen and blood, ready to sign. But he finally said, all right, I never even offered this to Tom Clancy, but when they make the movie versions, they will faithfully follow the plots of your books. That's one of the, if you get really successful and you get a movie contract, you may not recognize it, you know, when the movie's finished. You know. I've read various stories about authors who had movie contracts, and they were allowed to come out and actually paid some money to sit on be on the set and kind of watch everything went. And they were just astounded that stuff got changed instantly. Rewritten and changed, you know, it ended up being vastly different than the author had originally anticipated the movie was going to be. So be careful, it's one of the problems. In fact, some of them got thrown off the set finally because they were objecting so much. The stories are linked. What that means is that there's a common thread or threads that go throughout the book, all 17 stories. And in this case, the major thread is the same protagonist. You know, your hero, Rod Taylor, who we start with in story one, in his 20s in Vietnam. And we go with him all the way to his 20s and his 70s at the end of the book. And there's a sci-fi element to all of this. Because Rod, with the assistance of some government experimentation, ends up with a multiple personality disorder that when he's put under extreme stress, you know, the old reptilian portion of the brain, the amygdala, where the fight or flight instinct is, that comes up, kind of takes over during these high stress situations. And it happens often enough that it develops its own separate personality and it wants to take over. Wants to take over the body, and his original personality would be secondary or completely repressed. Let me see if I can find. the section where it's, here it is. It all started in Vietnam. Killed two men, stayed too long, betrayed by his commanders, kept getting tossed into life and death events. The more killing, the more the barriers broke. The reptile personality in the brain clawed out, became stronger, increasingly berserk each time. Rod was willing to die. Rod was willing to die, wanted to die. It didn't. Whatever acts the situation required to survive, the creature did, more than a normal man could stomach. So throughout the stories, you're going to see the creature surface again and again. Okay, let's start with Rod. In Vietnam, at night, the black came, blacker than black. Not just the absence of light, a blackness of sound, a blackness of mind and soul. It crept in, as it always did, after the rocket attacks, in those morning hours that one wanted to believe were inviolate. It grew so thick, the pulse of its organs could be felt against the skin. The blackness filled every surface and irregularity. The slow tide would crest the earth berm, leak through the sandbag bunkers to touch booted feet, then rise to groins and chests. It filled the barrels of rifles, pressed cloth against flesh, pushed out the air as it entered pores, nose, and ears, until this acid velvet was all there was. I prayed that while it had our bodies and minds, it would not take our souls. By some chance, God let us return. I knew it would still be inside us, making us lepers to wives and lovers, parents, friends, and worst of all, to each other. Pain in my knuckles brought me back a little. I pulled my fist back from the sandbag wall. We'd go out soon. I listened to the breathing of the others. The acrid odor of confined male fear burned my nostrils. I assured myself we were safe. The sides of the bunker were built into a 10-foot-high earth berm. The exposed front face consisted of four thicknesses of alternating sandbags, pounded with mallets into rock-hard walls. Overhead, rough-cut wood beams topped with perforated steel runway panels supported layers of sandbags. Similar bunkers looked out every 50 meters, their weapons ports aligned for interlocking fire. From a fan of claymore mines cemented in front, wires ran back to stacked detonators. Further out, rows of barbed wire entanglements, the height of a tall man, sealed us in. Even so, the threat of ground attack was not the danger tonight. Charlie's artillery rockets had delay fuses. They dug in deep, cratering the runways of the airstrip. They would also burst through bunker roofs before exploding. I didn't want to be one of those. I bled, leaking into the gasping dirt, suffocating while I listened to the muffled shouts of men above trying to dig me out. The attacks came three or four times a week, always in the early hours. The enemy didn't want you rested. After months of sleep deprivation and adrenaline highs, soldiers became emotionally bruised and unfocused, susceptible to delusions and neurotic behavior. I should know. There are reasons why the suicide rate among veterans is three times what it is among civilians. Do we have any military veterans here? What, you're young enough, what, Afghanistan or Iraq?
Afghanistan or Iraq.
you for your service. Yeah, I don't know, most of you have not been in an ambush before. You may be seeing some on television or in a movie. Here's an example. The monsoon rain beat at the men. Great gray pillars of rain stomped over everything. The triple canopy jungle surrounding the patrol never got dry. Water trickled off millions of exposed plant surfaces to make background noise unique to the season and place. One could hear the percussion of drops landing on leaves like a thousand brushed snare drums. Water fell on the top foliage, then dripped downward from leaf to leaf, accumulating until one heard the thrup, thrup, thrup noise of rivulets slapping the spongy jungle floor. Flesh could take the constant soaking, but standard issue, leather boots rotted out after 3 months. So far it had been one of the usual patrols, no sign of the enemy. One man took a punching stick in his calf on a pit track. Two others hauled him back, reducing the group to 9. The remaining men dealt with the damp misery by focusing on family, girlfriends, on the chance the next mail call would bring something good. Everyone drifted off in his own little world, lulled by the drumming, drumming, drumming of the rain. The dreams were better than reality, but not being alert to the here and now could get you killed. It happened fast. The detonation of a mine blasting air and steel balls down the trail, sweeping away Sergeant Brandt and 2 18-year-old privates. And the crazy roar of automatic weapons. The confetti of bullet-shredded plants, showered skin, clothes, and the falling, jerking bodies of the dying. Seconds became minutes as the brain flushed ancient survival drugs into arteries. Lieutenant Tegler saw the melting faces of the soldiers to his sides, plastic skin and putty muscles twisted into fear and pain. Bits of flesh and liquid sprayed out as slugs erupted from their backs. They were killing his men. He felt anger rise and burst. This time it was no ancient fight or flight instinct to emerge, but a wholly separate creature. Pure rage unlocked a deadly buried reptile, an ancient animal that dwells visibly in the core of all men. A creature that knows no fear, no mercy, and no restraint, only the madness of the moment. A guttural hiss began to form in his throat as his eyes shrunk to mere slits above lips forming a rictus. A machete grew into his sinews and bone. He rushed into the brush, slipping through resisting growth, running towards the enemy's green tracer bullets. Pausing out of the kill zone, possessed by newly released personality, the panting body crouched and cocked his head left and right, listening for the direction of firing. It was behind him. Leaping forward, the reptile saw smoke and steam rising over a prone enemy, firing an overheated rifle. The steel claw blade flashed down between the Viet Cong's neck and shoulder, then 3 more times, chopping open the skull. The creature ripped, stripped off the belt containing canteen, compass, and bandage. The bloody nylon shirt came ripping off. Shooting continued to the man reptile's right, bare-chested, he scurried toward the sound and rising mists of weapon smoke. The 11 or 12 Viet Cong in the ambush force remained laid out in a firing line at 10-foot intervals. Thick brush isolated them from each other. The angry flame in his mind grew over tones of green and blue, pleasure and disappointment. This was too easy. Anybody know where the word berserk comes from? It's a Scandinavian. You've been watching the Vikings, that series. They have berserkers that frequently would run into battle naked and could take wounds and keep fighting to stop normal men. I married a woman of Danish descent. I keep telling her that the only 2 words that we brought into English from Scandinavia were berserk and weird. And that's true. Berserk means the same thing that it did to them, but weird, they had a slightly different meaning. Scandinavians, too weird was fate. Was your fate. Of course, our fate could be really weird, so maybe that's how we decided to use the word. It doesn't mean fate in English, it means something strange. Great. The berserkers were so nasty, sometimes they would chew their shields, you know, and foam at the mouth. If you were a Viking on the other side, or an Englishman, or whoever they were trying, they were fighting, you didn't want to come up against one of those guys. Okay, something a little lighter. Romance. Is there people among us that write romance stories or romantic poetry? Okay. Tegler is, in this story, he's out of the military. He's back, and he's taking a vacation. He's got a new Dodge truck with a camper in the back. He is in Brewster County, Texas, which is actually a real county. And he has stopped 5 miles south of town at the Brewster County Historical Museum and Garden. And of course, Brewster County, that part of Texas, is also in the Chihuahuan Desert that goes from the United States all the way down into Mexico. It's a desert environment. On a whim, he pulled the camper-laden truck into the empty gravel lot. He could use some campground directions. The late afternoon sun reflected off the sandy ground, a shock after the air-conditioned cab. Rod hustled up the narrow sidewalk and stepped into the museum. The inside rewarded him with coolness. He heard a cheery, "Howdy, cowboy, what do you have?" His forward movement brought him belly up to a glass display case, equipped with stacked color brochures, jars of prickly pear jelly, and an NCR cash register. Standing behind the counter, a head shorter than himself, stood a redhead. Her short-cut hair was striking, not the carroty orange stuff accompanied by a massive freckle infection, but a deep dark magenta with ruby overtones. Looking down, he noticed she had just a sprinkle of freckles across the nicely shaped nose and upper cheekbones. The girl, woman, rested her forearms on the counter and stared up into his face. Pupils in her light brown eyes widened as he removed his sunglasses. "My name's Catherine O'Donnell Maloney. You can call me Pepper." He breathed in her perfume. It didn't appear to come from a bottle, just real woman scent. "Rod," he croaked, "Rod Tegler." His internal reptile companion tensed, also affected by the pheromones. A species memory flashed in his mind. Giant fin-backed, scaly male beast bellowed and fought in the riverbank mud as females his promises on the other side. He licked his lips. "I'd like to know more about this country, Pepper." She moved down from behind the counter and waved him into the interior. "I'm just the person to handle that desire, honey. Follow me." Tegler liked the tied-off man's blue gingham shirt and tight jeans. Looked like Pepper carried about 10 pounds more than she needed, but he had always been partial to curves, and that 10 pounds was all in the right places. So she gives him the tour. They get closer together, and he asked her for, finally asked her for campground directions. She said, "Well, why don't you just pull back to the museum? There's a plug-in there and a water fountain, and you can stay there." So he invites her to dinner. So they're in back of the museum. He's preparing dinner. The pair feasted on gala apple slices and red seedless grapes while Rod set up a two-burner Coleman stove on the outside table to fry scrambled eggs with green chilies and tomato salsa. Cold Scheinerbach beer accompanied the meal. He pulled a blue enamel percolator off the second burner. "Kona coffee, madam. Cap off the evening." "Oh, wait, I need one more item." Tegler vanished into the camper. Soon returned with a hooded sweatshirt and a mysterious bottle. "Put this on, my dear biologist. The desert feels a bit cool after dark. And something more to warm us," he said, waving a long-necked, dark bottle. Pulling out her coffee cup, Pepper said, "Napoleon brandy. You sure know how to treat a girl." The two continued coffee and conversation for another half hour, snuggled together to fox the cold air. During the stories of their lives chattered, Pepper seemed happy to learn he too came from a rural background. She knew more about cattle, he knew more about hogs. Both paraded childhood memories. Pigler mentioned his military service and the time spent in Vietnam, but refused to respond with details to her probing questions. After several more cognacs, they started telling funny stories about various relatives. The laughter grew in volume, scaring off all the prowling night creatures within 50 yards. The voices finally cast into silence. Pigler felt huge hands squeezing his heart. His temperature flared. The reptile opened jaws, tongue flicked out tasting, the tip of his tail quivered. The woman's muscles tensed as she felt her own heart song merge into his. The sexual tension as thick, rich, and sweet as chocolate brownies. Pepper took his shaking hands and led him into the camp. You want to find out what else happened? You're going to have to. How are we doing on time, Chuck? 5 minutes?
Yeah, about five.
Okay, I'll time for one more. Do the, let's see. Do the ghost story. Tegler and two of his buddies from Vietnam form a detective agency and also a physical security agency. And they are in this particular story, they're in Europe. In France, and they're bidding on the security contract for the Euro Disney park there. And they're in a old castle that's been remodeled into to a hotel. Hector sat on a roche bois, gray leather grand canapé, sipped the young good wine from the castle's vineyards, and listened to Pappy Wallace finish a joke. I reached down, picked up that frog, and slipped her into my shirt pocket. She stuck her wart-speckled green head out and said, I don't understand. I said, if you kiss me, I'd turn into a beautiful princess and be your sex slave forever. Why won't you do it? I looked down at that little darling and replied, at my age, I'd rather have a talking frog. Laughter rose and bounced off the high ceiling. Echoes returned to fill the space. As though the jolly gods and satyrs painted on the ceiling were joining in the mirth. Someone standing outside would have thought the room had held three times its dozen occupants. Pappy was always telling jokes about his age. A three-war veteran, the almost 70-year-old remained as active as a much younger man, except for the cane he used when his old war wound acted up. He served as the team's weapon expert and trainer. The next oldest person besides Tegler was a 30-year-old computer expert. So Pappy took his fatherly role seriously. Only a stupid person would threaten any of his charges. A short-lived stupid person. Tegler stood to raise his wine glass and made a toast to the group before leaving. Your very excellent work has landed us the Euro Disney contract, exposing the incompetence of our competitor, Securité, and opening up the Eurozone to Cerberus. To everyone here, a bonne santé and a night of pleasant dreams. He jogged up the stairs to the fourth floor of the oldest tower, entering the suite of rooms through the bedroom. Beyond, behind a sliding pocket door, lay a sitting room with couches, chairs, and plants, facing a floor-to-ceiling arched window, which caught the cream-colored light of the morning. A modern bathroom and a small office completed the floor plan. The whole thing was called the Gobert Suite, after the medieval nobleman who built the towers. Over the fireplace in the bedroom hung a very old oil painting of Alice, the last countess of that family, to walk the halls and gardens. Recently restored and cleaned, the blonde lady of the castle appeared serene and beautiful until you noticed her eyes. Those slightly slanted and sensuous-lidded orbs give away the passion hiding within. She must have been some package. The centerpiece of the room was a four-poster oak panel bed, complete with dark brown velvet curtains that could be drawn to keep out drafts. The antique had come with the castle, passed down from one succeeding owner to another. The mattress, however, had been modernized. Could this be the bed Alice and the Count had shared? Tigler pondered the thought as he shed his clothes, slipped between the sheets, and started to catch up on his business reading. 3 hours later, he woke with the papers scattered across his chest. He tossed them on the floor, shut off the light, and rolled over. He jerked awake again in the early hours, confused, breath stuck in his lungs. Gasping and choking, he tried to rise. An invisible presence held him down, its heavy weight filling the curves of his body, pressing him deep into the mattress. A few more moments and he would pass out. Tegler started to panic in the lack of air. He couldn't even twitch. Dark circles formed and scrolled inward from the rim to the center of his vision. From a deep spirit well within him, fire blew forth. The reptile personality flushed into his mind and body, filling every organ and muscle. The weight disappeared. The body leaped out of the bed to land on all fours, butt wagging as though lashing a phantom tail. Lungs filled, golden vertical irises scanned the room. Breath hissed out in a challenge. The reptile saw nothing, detected nothing. Apparently, only humans could see ghosts. Deep inside, Tegler peered forth. He watched the bedclothes writhe and hump. Sweet voices murmured. A man clothed in a long gold brocaded dressing gown opened the door and stumbled toward the bed. His pale, featureless, open face caught the moonlight through the window. A clenched hand held a long poniard or dagger. The shadow plunged the two-handed weapon down into the bed, thrusting again and again. He heard a tiny muffled scream, followed by silence broken only by the killer's heavy breathing, then nothing. The reptile stared, confused by the terror felt by the man portion of its awareness. It had not, could not detect any threat. It returned to its mental lair, leaving the naked man shivering against the cold stone floor of the empty room. You want to find out more about the ghost?
Yeah.
Here it is.
Wow. All right, thank you very much. Before we move down to room 202 for the refreshments, we have a few minutes for question and answer, comments for Dennis. Feel free, please.
Like, that's the question I'm going to ask you. You'll be graded.
Dennis, you're amazing.
Thank you, man.
Yes. We sat across from each other at meetings, and I knew you were a poet and a writer, and I had no idea to what extent. Truly, I guess. Yeah.
It's interesting. One creative art has a way of expanding into another. Of course, everybody's aware that song lyrics are all poetry. People think that we're not exposed to poetry. I haven't heard any poetry since I was in high school. Wrong. it's there every day. You listen to any song with music with a lyric, you're listening to some poetry. Plus, I see it all the time on commercials on television. They're always doing some kind of little poetic thing there. Especially the Levi jeans has had some ads in the last couple of years. It was Walt Whitman. If you want to go out to my website, I had a composer pick 5 of my haiku and set it to neoclassical music. It's out on the website. And the website's www.dennismaulsby.com. And you can also hear the music that Chuck referred to, a poem that was played on National Public Radio for the 60th anniversary of the Omaha Beach Landings. They put Marlene Dietrich singing in German as the background music.
Wow.
I've always wanted to perform with Marlene Dietrich. So you can get your wishes sometime. These creative professions.
Did you start one particular form of poetry that you?
Mostly free verse to start with.
Okay.
And then I got into haiku. I really like haiku because it's very short. Those who are familiar with it, it's like 3 lines, 17 syllables. That's all it is. And so you have to be precise. You have to make sure you get your images in there in a way that intrigues the writer or the reader. And if you take those three lines and you put them all together, you've got the neatest, high visual sensuality sentence that you've ever had. And so it tends to be wonderful for writers of prose, especially your first sentence in each chapter. If you have it, they tend to be great hooks. People read that and go, wow, and they start to read the rest of it. So you pull them into your writing.
You did that in your book?
There's some, there are some haiku in here, yes. They, I can't emphasize enough getting into a good poetry group or a good class where you have, you're able to be critiqued and be advised. Because when I first started, all I wanted was the therapy, you know, getting this stuff out in some kind of a creative form. And you know, I was about three or four meetings, and the members of the local group said, Dennis, you need to put these in a book. Do it. So I got the encouragement I needed to further evolve in the profession. So I encourage you all, put them in a book. One publication would be very useful is Poets and Writers Magazine. That they have lots of good articles about all kinds of writing. And they also have a classified section in the back where they list journals and publishing houses that are advertising for manuscripts. And also list contests. You want to enter contests. So I strongly suggest you get that, or you go out, at least go out on their website. Take a look at what they've got.
Who do you like to read?
I'd like to read everything. So I've read all of the traditional poets, and I got the books. I got all these books. Whenever we move, the movers love us. They charge you by the pound. So here's all these books. You're there, oh boy, this is good. They're packing them up. They're just, the dollar signs are cranking over in their heads. But I've got all the traditional poets, and I also I try to buy the chat books and the books of poets that I know, or when I go to poetry readings, you know, I will at least buy one of the books and you know, get into it in depth and try to learn from it. You know, because you never know. There's something else there that might be interesting that you could work into your own work, or a particularly useful and intriguing choice of words, or words that are arranged in certain ways, you know, like combination words. Combination words are those that are two words connected by a hyphen. And we have a lot of combination words in English that have shed the hyphen, like air conditioning. That was two words when originally came out. It was air hyphen conditioning. Now we don't write it that way anymore. It's been so commonplace, we've done away with the hyphen. But you can actually create new words with combination words, whether it's nouns, adjectives, adverbs, or verbs. Put those words together with a hyphen, you've got a whole brand new word.
Have you done that?
Yes.
Curious.
And you can see some of them. So, all right. Very intriguing.
Well, thank you once again, Dennis. We'll move down the hall for some refreshments, please. Join us, everybody. They're free. There's some nice stuff down there, as I said. I made sure that it was okay for all of us to eat.
Napoleon brandy?
I didn't see any down there. What do you have in your bag there?